Good morning. Can I begin by saying just how grateful I am to be here in the States. This is my first visit to the States. I've been through LA a few times, but I figure that doesn't really count. So, you know, here I am, and you've been such gracious hosts, such generous hosts. Thank you, Michael, for arranging that, for the invitation to come, for such a brilliant venue and great conference, good discussion. I'm just enormously grateful. Thank you. I also bring greetings from that team of editors of Richard Baxter's autobiography. So we're led by Neil Keeble, also John Coffey and Tom Charlton. We are hard at work on that edition. We've been hard at work for a very long time. It's a very long autobiography. 645,000 words in that autobiography. By the time we're done, we're going to have around 1.3 million words, we think, in five volumes. I say that because you should start saving now. you know, £600, you've got a couple of years before it comes out. It's going to be an excellent resource for Baxter's world, right? And its excellence, I think, lies in Neil Keeble, who's a retired professor, who's got so much time, so much expertise, so much experience. And we are going to share in Neil's reflected glory, those of us on the team. It will be, I think I can assure you, a magnificent resource. So greetings also from my colleagues in that project. So today, I want to, as Michael has said, talk to you a little bit about this battle for Calvin and John Owen and Richard Baxter's part in that. It's not so much a follow-on from my book in that book looked at, you know, particularly Owen and Baxter not liking each other. This is not necessarily the part of the same argument, but clearly involves the same two players. So let's see how we go. In 1985, J. Wayne Baker offered an account of the battle for Luther in 17th century England. That battle did not go well. By the end of the century, the very idea of justification, sola fide, sola gratia, was in bad repute. Residual support for his soteriology existed mainly in small pockets within nonconformity. Luther's influence slowly but surely had been eroded among the English clergy in the space of one century. If Baker had focused on John Calvin, the story would have been just as bleak. As G.R. Craig famously put it, there was no more striking change in English religious thought than what he called the overthrow of Calvinism. To quote him, at the beginning of the century, it had dominated the religious life of England. By the end, its power had been completely overthrown. While the reality was not quite as stark as that, the downward trajectory is undeniable. It is easy enough to trace the main outlines of Calvin's decline. Nicholas Tyack has long since demonstrated that an initial Calvinist dominance within the theology of the Church of England faced the challenge of a rising Arminianism during the 1620s and 1630s. The chaos of the 1640s, together with the failure of Puritan rule during the 1650s, served to discredit Calvinism, which was ever after associated in the minds of many with sedition, disorder, impiety, fanaticism, and rebellion. At the same time, Socinianism came increasingly to the fore within intellectual circles. Socinians read the scriptures in a uniformly flat way to dissolve what they perceived as an imposed doctrinal overlay of Trinitarian Christology, all of which had ominous implications for soteriology. The glimmerings of an early enlightenment appeared in a new confidence in human reason after the Restoration, illustrated by the Cambridge Platonists with their quiet Arminianism and a broad shift of emphasis from grace to nature. Latitudinarians focused on human reason, natural truths, and moral duties in preference to obscure points of doctrine. Thus, growing numbers of English thinkers and theologians felt that it was improper and distasteful to pry into hidden mysteries such as predestination and election, and preferred to leave in the past any memory of religious enthusiasm. We should not be surprised, then, to find that Calvinist doctrine was marginal to England's national, religious, and intellectual life by the later 17th century. As Dewey Wallace explains, the Reformed or Calvinist consensus generally acknowledged to have prevailed in the Reformation Church of England up to the time of Charles I and Archbishop Laud had faded by the era of the Restoration, partly discredited by the putative disorder of Puritan rule as Calvinism lost prestige and authority. What interests me is that Calvinism declined not just among the population at large, but also among those whom we might expect to hold it fast, the Puritans. They did not reside in some intellectual backwater where they were immune to these more general developments. To quote Wallace once more, the Calvinist view of predestination, apparently so plausible to an earlier generation of Puritans, was a rock of offence to many by the middle of the 17th century. And they had to confront that reality. In response, Puritans evolved and adapted their own positions in at least three ways. First, they could, like the London Puritan minister John Goodwin, abandon Calvinism altogether and go over to Arminianism. In Redemption Redeemed, published in 1651, he argued the case for a universal atonement. He could no longer accept the Calvinist doctrine of predestination as it had been developed, could not accept that it was consistent with either Scripture or God's nature, and he disliked its inclination towards antinomianism. A second response was to moderate one's Calvinism. Here, Richard Baxter contributed significantly to the changing theological climate in the middle of the century. Tying into an earlier tradition of English hypothetical universalism, he reshaped Calvinism in a more rational, synergistic, moralistic direction by introducing a central place for human responsibility and covenant conditions alongside God's infallible election. Baxter was central to a circle of Puritan figures such as Roger Morris, William Bates, John Howe, and Daniel Williams, who have come down to us as Baxterians, nonconformists who accommodated human agency and obedience in the economy of salvation. Mark Goldie sees this as a Presbyterian, quote, retreat from Calvinism. By the end of the century, the Presbyterians were taking steps towards Arminianism and even Socinianism, and that was largely due to Baxterian influence. A third response was to hold the line and to defend Calvinism for all it was worth, though not without some inevitable adaptation. This has come down to us as High Calvinism. Here, John Owen was the foremost expositor of High Calvinism, quoting Wallace again, in England in the second half of the 17th century. But like Baxter, he was not alone. The Westminster Assembly served to codify and partly revivify Reformed theology in England, and that fed into the Congregationalist Savoy Confession of 1658 and the Particular Baptist Confession of 1677 and 1689, which allows me in passing to bring in William Kiffen into the same paper. That's all three. More generally, the demise of Calvinism triggered a significant number of defences and rich restatements of Reformed theology, many of them prefaced by Owen. So a range of responses lay open. In this paper, I want to suggest a few of the mechanisms that might account for the internal dynamics of those responses. I'll begin in the mid-1670s, when the writings of William Sherlock and George Bull triggered an extended moment of particular controversy. To give some sense of perspective, Christopher Haig has been doing some counting. I quote, "By now it was open house on justification and everyone joined in. Between 1675 and 1680, 53 works relating to the justification controversy were published by 34 different authors, including our old friends Baxter, 6 books, Owen, 3, Simon Patrick, 2, Vincent Alsop, 2, and Edward Fowler. The debate was at its hottest in 1675 and 1676, with 18 and 11 books respectively, and then things cooled down with 6 in 1667, 8 in 1678, 2 in 1679, and a late burst of 8 in 1680. I have no intention of dealing with all those authors, let alone all their books. Instead, I will focus only on John Owen and Richard Baxter, and only on a very small number of their works. I would like to borrow from Tony Lane the language of concerns, which he uses in the context of contemporary Protestant Catholic dialogue. Quote, "It is important to pay attention not just to the doctrines put forward by each side, but also to the concerns that underlie those doctrines. If each side can be brought to understand and value the concerns of the other, considerable progress can be made." It is too late now, of course, to orchestrate some sort of ecumenical dialogue between Owen and Baxter. But it will help us to understand their part in this controversy if we appreciate the concerns that compelled them. I will argue that each man's concern was quite different from that of the other. And I would like to go further still and to ask why each man had the concern that he had. In other words, I hope to push past concern to get to motivation. To some degree, the exercise will inevitably involve a degree of speculation, but that is potentially helpful and certainly interesting. I'm starting to show my age. I'm just going to see if this helps. Look at that. I've only just moved on to these. You can tell I'm mid to late 40s. That's me. Well, it is not difficult to identify Baxter's chief concern when he published Catholic Theology in 1675, since it is right there on the title page. Richard Baxter's Catholic Theology, plain, pure, peaceable, for the pacification of the dogmatical word warriors. The title page signals a work in 3 parts: pacifying principles, pacifying praxis, pacifying disputations. Thus, the book is testament to Baxter's consistent concern over the previous 3 decades for unity and concord, and testament to the apparent fruitlessness of all his efforts. The preface to Catholic Theology opens with this truth: that the churches of Christ are dolefully tempted and distracted by divisions, no man will deny that knoweth them. The problem, as he had come to discern, was that the doctrinal controversies among Protestants were far more about equivocal words than matter. All words are merely signs, and ambiguous ones at that. If the disputants could but see into each other's minds, they would realize that they agreed in the substance of things, even if they disagreed about the human language in which to express those shared truths. Quote again, Baxter, "And so taking verbal differences for material doth keep up most of the wretched academical and theological wars of the world." Baxter's solution to this problem was twofold. First, he consistently advocated a minimalist creed as a test of orthodoxy. Only the baptismal covenant and the Apostles' Creed. This avoided the multiplication of words that came with extended confessions and elaborate statements of orthodoxy. the fewer words involved and the more general their nature, the less chance there was of misunderstanding over the sense of things those words were intended to convey. The second part of Baxter's solution was this. If one really did have to use words, be very precise about how one was using them. So the first part of Catholic theology carefully dissected a long list of terms integral to the debate in an intricate philosophical discussion replete with Latin phrases and innumerable logical distinctions. But this introduced a tension, if not an outright contradiction. In his preface, Baxter complained that, I quote, "human formalities of wisdom have prevailed to bring the scripture into disesteem, as if logical, physical, and metaphysical trifling were a higher matter." He criticized, quote again, "scholars with forms and notions instead of knowledge," end of quote. Yet so much of his book dealt in forms and notions. If the problem lay in a multiplication of words, it is difficult to see how anyone else in 17th century England multiplied words more than Baxter, not least in Catholic theology. Have you seen that? Have you seen that book? That thick. This is a blind spot of spectacular proportions. But before we condemn him for it, we should seek to understand his concerns. He entered into soteriological debate for essentially ecclesiological reasons. His overriding concern was Christian unity. He admitted at the end of his preface that "I have meddled much with controversies in this book, but it is to end them." There was never any hope of that, and certainly not with the self-defeating methods he chose to employ. But we can acknowledge his aim, which was genuine enough. John Owen entered into soteriological debate for essentially soteriological reasons. In 1676, he published The Nature of Apostasy from the Profession of the Gospel. In explaining why he wrote the book, Owen opened with this truth: that the state of religion is at this day deplorable in most parts of the Christian world is acknowledged by all. It's almost exactly what Baxter opened with. So these opening words parallel those of Baxter, but Owen's frame of reference was quite different. Rather than worrying over Christian division, he deplored England's retreat from the Protestant Reformation. His book was an exposition of Hebrews 6, with its stern warning to those who had once been enlightened, now tempted to fall away. He lamented, quote, "the woeful declension from the power and purity of evangelical truth." All around him, people grow weary of the truths which have been possessed ever since the Reformation. In his recollection of history, the 39 articles and the Book of Homilies encased Calvinism at the heart of the Church of England, where it stayed for the next 60 years until the Arminians came along to erode it. A new Pelagianism, quote, "did secretly and gradually insinuate itself into the animal and vital spirits of the body of the Church in those days," followed by the leprosy of Socinianism. As a result, the Reformation hath visibly and apparently lost its force and gone backwards on all accounts. Those to blame included not just the Catholics and Socinians, but Reformed Protestants. I shall instance only in the known doctrines of the Reformed churches, aiming especially at what is of late years falling out among ourselves. Here, Reformed religion is by not a few so taken off from its old foundations, so unhinged from those pillars of important truths which it did depend upon, and so sullied by a confused medley of noisome opinions, as that its loss and reputation of stability and usefulness seems almost irreparable. There is a touch of the Jeremiad about Owen's lament. As we have seen in certain quarters, there was a notable profusion of Calvinist publications. But we have also seen that he was right to be worried. Trinitarian orthodoxy in England was passing into eclipse. Thus he injected himself into the controversy over justification to try to haul England back from the brink of abandoning the Reformation altogether. I'm not suggesting that Baxter and Owen were targeting each other in their respective publications. No man mentioned the other explicitly, and there were numerous other authors involved in the controversy. It is scarcely credible that Baxter did not have Owen, at least partly in mind, when he wrote his books, and the same can be said for Owen, but that is not important. What I am saying is that Baxter and Owen came into the controversy with different concerns in mind, and those different concerns shaped quite different lines of argument. Let me illustrate what I mean. In 1677, Owen published The Doctrine of Justification by Faith Through the Imputation of the Righteousness of Christ, Explained, Confirmed, and Vindicated. The book worked its way out from Romans 11, verse 6. If salvation is by grace, it is no longer on the basis of works. Otherwise, grace would no longer be grace. Salvation rested either on what humans can show for themselves, their own repentance, obedience, and works of righteousness, or on the obedience, righteousness, and merit of Jesus Christ that is imputed to them. For the purpose of one's justification before God, they do not mix. Yet, as Owen observed, various authors had tried to blend them together. In so doing, they had moved away from the clear truths of Scripture. What they had done was to place human reason over Scripture and to make it the judge of Scripture. As well as mixing human righteousness and Christ's righteousness, they had mixed divine revelation with philosophical speculation. The result was division, a point that echoed Baxter's own concern. And, I quote, "The truth for the most part, as unto the concernment of the souls of men therein, is utterly lost and buried in a rubbish of senseless and unprofitable words. No proposition can be so plain," he said at one point, "but that a man ordinarily versed in metaphysical notions may multiply distinctions on every word of it. Such men construct an elaborate, tangled thicket. They consider principally how they may entangle others, scarce at all how they may get out of it themselves." For that reason, Owen resolved as far as possible to avoid philosophical terms and distinctions. At one point, in a moment of extended irony, he caricatured seven distinctions said to be necessary for understanding justification aright. For each distinction, there were several more, the actual grounds of which only the most well-educated could discern. In Owen's view, this led the poor, bewildered seeker away from the saving truths of the Bible into a set of impenetrable distinctions they could not possibly understand, and a set of distinctions that could not save. "My inquiry," he says, "is how I shall come before the Lord and bow myself before the high God. How shall I escape the wrath to come? What shall I plead in judgment before God?" Those were questions of greatest urgency. But if, quote, "I should be harnessed with 1,000 of these distinctions, I am afraid they would prove thorns and briars which God would pass through and consume." So where others, in Owen's view, subjugated Scripture to the dictates of human reason, he appealed to Scripture alone, reinforced by experience. It is this emphasis on experience that I find so interesting. We have already seen how little help intricate philosophical distinctions were to the humble seeker. In his turn, Owen appealed only to, quote, the authority of God in Scripture, rejoicing only in this, that we can set our seal unto his revelations by our own experience. Every true believer who is taught of God knows how to put his whole trust in Christ alone and the grace of God by him. To suggest that salvation rests in the understanding of certain philosophical distinctions, quote, answers not the experience of them that truly believe. It would avoid a great many problems if men would attend to their own experience in the application of their souls unto God for the pardon of sin and righteousness to life. Owen's advice, keep to the Bible alone. To quote him again, all other disputes about qualifications, conditions, causes, any kind of interest for our own works and obedience and our justification before God are but the speculations of men at ease. The conscience of a convinced sinner who presents himself in the presence of God finds all practically reduced unto this one point, namely, whether he will trust unto his own personal inherent righteousness or, in a full renunciation of it, partake himself unto the grace of God and the righteousness of Christ alone. The only answer that could satisfy was the saving truth of the Bible. Everything else was but the complacent speculations of men at ease. To repeat my point, Owen could have had any number of authors in mind when he offered this extended critique. But it has to be said that Richard Baxter fitted the bill pretty well. In his first publication, The Aphorisms of Justification, published in 1649, Baxter had laid out a system of soteriology that distinguished between the legal righteousness that God supplies and the evangelical righteousness that the believer provides. This evangelical righteousness involved the sincere but imperfect performance of the gospel conditions, namely faith, which encompassed repentance, obedience, and perseverance. Right from the beginning, Baxter blended Christ's righteousness with the believer's righteousness. And this was just the first of countless distinctions that Baxter offered up in the course of his long career, not least in Catholic theology, where they came thick and fast. In the course of that work, Baxter tendered a typically half-hearted apology for minor infelicities in the aphorisms of justification, but he stood by the doctrine it delivered. Moreover, in 1676, Baxter engineered an affirmation of reason in the judgment of nonconformists of the interest of reason in matters of religion, signed by 15 men within his circle. Baxter seemed to be reinforcing those trends that so worried Owen, not standing against them. We are beginning to see that the two men were governed by quite different instincts. At the risk of being too simplistic, Owen's instinct was either or. That is why Romans 11:6 sat so well with him. In his view, quote, everything in and of ourselves under any consideration whatever seems to be excluded from our justification before God. Faith alone accepted, whereby we receive his grace and the atonement. But Baxter's instinct was not either or. It was both and. The second book in Catholic theology is a fascinating fictional exchange that takes place over 13 days and 299 folio pages. It is a series of long discussions that traverse every aspect of the doctrine of justification. It is, for the most part, a discourse between A, B, and C. A is an Arminian, C is a Calvinist, and B is, of course, Baxter. Starts with B, handily. Who styles himself throughout variously as the reconciler, the conciliator, or the peacemaker. He is determined to show A and C that there is no material difference between them. So one of B's earliest responses is this. These are words of confusion which, when opened, will appear nothing, and that we are all of a mind. My understanding is this, he says. In the points of predestination and redemption, there is no difference between moderate men of each party. At the surface level, there may appear to be differences, but look below that and, quote, there is no real difference, end of quote. Look below that again and there is, quote, either no difference at all or else such as is not worthy to be insisted on. Once again, we see Baxter's overriding concern to bring about peace and concord. It is essential for him to show that despite their disagreement over words, the moderates on both sides agree in the sense of things. In the wake of yet one more distinction, B says this to A, if you understand the distinction aright, they say the same as you. That is why the tools of philosophy were so important for Baxter's project. They helped to understand distinctions aright, and if that were possible, the antagonists would see that they were in broad agreement. They would settle on a truce. At the beginning of the second day's conference, now between C and B, B explains how, quote, these factions and church-dividing contentions come from a false conceit that each side is so dangerously erroneous, as that all good men must stir up their zeal, and with all their disputing skill and contending fervency must arm to defend the truth against them, and to save the church and the souls of men from the infection of their error. He might have been describing Owen at that point. Whatever the case, here B spoke of taking up arms in metaphorical terms, but elsewhere he was much more literal. Right at the beginning of the book, he listed the calamitous consequence of contention between Arminians and Calvinists. This very controversy, he explains, was a grand part of the difference which on both sides was prosecuted till it brought us to our doleful war, the civil wars of the 1640s. Continued contention and controversy risked not just a war of words, but another war on the ground. To forestall that possibility, Baxter stepped in as a peacemaker. He tried to show each side that there was a spacious middle ground in which they all could stand in concord. In sum, therefore, Owen held on to his Calvinism because his frame of reference was either or. Baxter moderated his Calvinism because his frame of reference was both and. If there was a battle for Calvin in later 17th century England, Owen wanted to win it. Baxter wanted to end it. But to return to my earlier point, the really interesting question is why? Why did each man possess this different frame of reference? I have no wish to offer a naive reductionist answer to the complex question of why people believe what they believe, but I do want to say something that might form part of an answer in this case. I want to take my lead from Owen and to think for a moment about experience. I'm now going to leave the 1670s behind and take the story back several decades to the formative experiences that shaped Owen and Baxter in their different ways. During the 1640s, Baxter went through a soteriological transition in which his theology of salvation was entirely inverted. He went into the decade holding a set of doctrines that were not just Calvinist, but antinomian. He admitted in the aphorisms he had, quote, remained long in the borders of antinomianism, which I very narrowly escaped. In 1645, he had visited friends in the New Model Army after its victory at Naseby, only to find that bad doctrine was rife. Arminianism on one side and far more prevalent and concerning antinomianism on the other. He began to see where his own doctrines might take him. 2 years of contending against heresy and error as an army chaplain came to an end deep in the winter of early 1647 in a crisis of ill health. The severe cold brought on a bleeding nose. Baxter concluded that he needed to reduce his body's evident surfeit of blood by opening four veins. The treatment very nearly killed him. During his recovery, he had a profound experience that precipitated the inversion of his soteriology. It became anti-antinomian. In a moment of dazzling clarity, the system he outlined in the aphorisms fell into place. And if you want more justification for that argument, that was my first book on Baxter. But here's the point. I would argue that Baxter's Civil War experience left him in some measure traumatized. For the rest of his life, he lived in the shadow of that trauma. Even before the fighting began, he was chased out of Kidderminster by a mob that threatened to kill him. He was on hand to witness the first physical skirmish of the wars, the ambush at Powick Bridge. That's still, every time I think about that, it amazes me. I mean, this was an ambush. This is by definition unplanned. No one's there to see it except Baxter, right? He sees the whole thing. It's uncanny that he was there to see that. Precisely a month later, he surveyed the field on which lay around 1,000 corpses, men killed during the Battle of Edge Hill the previous day. And if you read The Saints' Everlasting Rest, I think that image, you know, it's hard to appreciate what 1,000 dead bodies looks like, but I think that image stayed with him. And you can see it showing up in The Saints' Everlasting Rest. And in his tenure as an army chaplain, he witnessed several battles and sieges. Though it may seem a small thing now, a bleeding nose can be a symptom of intense stress. It is a dangerous thing to try to assess the psychology of an individual in the past. Even so, the wars left Baxter with a deep and abiding desire for order and stability. In A Holy Commonwealth, published in 1659, Baxter reviewed how the civil wars had changed him. The experiences of war and the evils that attend and follow it hath made me hate it incomparably more than I did before I tried or knew it. And the name of peace, much more the thing, is now exceeding amiable to me. I think that all of us did rush too eagerly into the heat of divisions and war, and none of us did so much as we should have done to prevent it. And though I was in no capacity to have done much, yet I unfeignedly repent that I did no more for peace in my place than I did, and that I did not pray more heartily against contention and war before it came, and spake no more against it than I did, and that I spoke so much to blow the coals. For this I daily beg forgiveness of the Lord through the precious blood of the great reconciler. Baxter was determined never to make the same mistake again, and always to speak for peace and concord in order to prevent a recurrence of that earlier trauma. And I think that quote is quite revealing. I don't know if you noticed it, but he paired divisions and war, contention and war, in a way that suggests both are similar in kind, even if division and contention do not involve any physical fighting. There was a part of Baxter that wanted all wars to end. Owen's temperament was quite different. Or at least his temperament was not chastened by the wars as Baxter's had been. We can see that in Owen's first book, A Display of Arminianism, published in 1643. The gospel was simply too important to allow it to be obfuscated in the interest of maintaining peace and harmony. Quote, "Surely these are not things about which we may differ without loss of peace and charity. One church cannot wrap in her communion Augustine and Pelagius, Calvin and Arminius. We must not offer the right hand of fellowship, but rather proclaim a holy war to such enemies of God's providence, Christ's merit, and the powerful operation of the Holy Spirit." There it is again. Right at the start of his publishing career, that instinct for either or. Don't try to sit Calvin and Arminius in the same pew. Thank you very much. Do not ask Augustine and Pelagius to take communion together. Even the church's peace is not sufficient grounds to justify the smallest dilution of the gospel. "Give but the least admission," he said, "and the whole Arminian poison must be swallowed." Where Baxter yearned for peace, Owen declared a holy war. Why was Owen prepared to forsake peace and harmony if that was required to preserve the gospel? Here I'm speculating. We might venture back in his experience to the 1630s, when, in the words of John Asti, one of his earliest biographers, Owen fell into a deep melancholy that continued in its extremity for a quarter of a year, during which time he avoided almost all manner of converse, and very hardly could be induced to speak a word, and when he did speak, it was with such disorder as rendered him a wonder to many. Though his distress and melancholy did not abide in that violence, yet he was held under very great trouble of mind and grievous temptations for a long time, and it was near 5 years before he attained a settled peace. The peace that mattered most to Owen, I think, was not the peace of the world around him. It was that inner peace only the gospel could provide. His very great troubles and distresses of soul, Asti says, were succeeded with a great degree of lasting serenity and joy. I realise this is a stylized and second-hand account written some 80 years after the event. Even so, faced with some sort of crisis, it is plausible to imagine the sense of relief Owen might have felt to be assured that the resources for his own salvation did not lie within himself, but were fully provided by Christ. "How shall I escape the wrath to come?" may have been for him a question of genuine urgency, and the answer a source of lasting relief and assurance. I'm very aware of the danger of patronising both Owen and Baxter. I'm not presuming on any ability of mine to look from the lofty heights of the present down upon these two men from the 17th century and to discern motives that were hidden even from them. I'm not for one moment thinking that the thesis I have put forward explains everything about their contribution to soteriological controversy. I am not suggesting that a person's theology is merely the sum of their experience, merely contingent, with no purchase in what is real. What I am suggesting is that each man's experience is not irrelevant to the concerns that lay behind his theology. Experience conditions theology, even if it does not determine it. Therefore, by working backwards from the 1670s, we have come to a fascinating set of contrasts in the formation of Owen and Baxter. Baxter experienced almost 5 years of trauma and upheaval, but the violence he experienced took the form of physical conflict, displacement, and itinerancy. Owen experienced near 5 years of trauma and upheaval, but the violence he experienced took the form of very great troubles and distresses of soul. As far as I know, there is no evidence linking the eventual resolution of Owen's internal distress to a Calvinist understanding of the gospel, but I don't think that's an unreasonable assumption. If that is the case, it helps to explain why he held on to it so tenaciously. His extended season of inner distress may have left him with a felt need to look outside himself for the resources in his own salvation. In contrast, the ruinous experience of the wars gave Baxter little confidence in the external world. His pastoral success at Kidderminster involved the right ordering of his physical and social environment, which is one reason why he was so devastated when it was all dismantled at the Restoration. That need to control his environment may have facilitated a style of soteriology that put such a premium on human behaviour and the continuance of human behaviour across a lifetime. If that is the case, Baxter's experience may shed a little light on the broader demise of Calvinism in England, and in particular the place of the civil wars in that development. Historians do not concern themselves with what might have happened. Though it's interesting, isn't it, Michael? Very interesting. Let's do that little what-if exercise. It is plausible that without the wars, think about this for a moment, without the wars, Baxter might have come down to us as one of the most important and significant defenders of Calvinism in the 17th century. But that is not what happened. In the mid-1640s, Baxter had been trying to ward off the antinomians while still sharing their doctrinal predispositions. That was no longer tenable, and he moved quickly to a new shape of things. In similar terms, the wars seemed to discredit Calvinist speculation, which left people open to alternatives that emphasized human moral responsibility, moderation, and good behavior. Orthodox Calvinism became unviable for a great many English Puritans, in large part because of Baxter's influence, and within the population at large. If so, this is further evidence that ideas are not pristine. Biography matters. The decline of Calvinism in England is not unrelated to Richard Baxter's bleeding nose.
a good amount of time for questions. And Roger?
Could you tell me the name of that scholar that you used that seems to be the fulcrum point for your attention? You mentioned him earlier.
Dewey Wallace? Or which, well, I mentioned a few.
You were talking about coming to a point of discussion from different, to the main point of discussion, but coming from different perspectives.
Oh, yes, sorry, Tony Lane, and his language of concerns. Yes.
Language of concerns.
Yeah.
That's rhetorical.
Well, yeah, sure. Yep.
Wow. Tony Lane.
Tony Lane. It's a book on justification in Catholic Protestant dialogue.
Language of concerns.
Yeah. Well, he talks about concerns. Yeah.
Thanks for that great presentation. Early on, you suggested there was a contradiction in Baxter's method between saying we need to minimize words, but then he is actually maximizing words.
Yeah.
And I may have missed something, but at least in the way you presented it, at least what I heard, it didn't seem like there was such a self-evident contradiction, because at least what I was hearing was Baxter wanted, in terms of kind of creedal statements, things that everyone's being asked to sign on to,
yep,
to minimize words.
Yep.
But the task then of the theologian might be, in dialogue with other theologians, might be to maximize, to fill a lot of words to explain why the ordinary Christian only needs to say a few words.
Yep. Yeah, no, you're onto something, and I'm not going to disagree with you, because Baxter's point about a minimalist creed is for, here's sort of everyone in the pew, right, whose understanding is going to be pretty limited. So let's keep it very simple and straightforward, and that's a test of orthodoxy. He allowed for more sophisticated texts that would go beyond scripture language that theologians might use. And of course, he wouldn't deny beyond that theologians have every right to talk for as long as they want about those basic beliefs in elaborating them. But my point about the contradiction is not just in point one, which over a minimalist creed, but also over this raising of reason and philosophical terms over the Bible and subjugating the Bible to those terms. And there as well, I think he was contradictory, because as he went on in Catholic theology, the Latin terms and distinctions just go on and on and on and on. And so it's a generalized sort of inherent contradiction that at one place, and I agree it's a limited place where he says, let's use as few words as possible. But that's not what Baxter does. Arguably, technically, maybe too hard on the guy at that point. But I just wanted to bring out how his means don't always fit his ends. So the things that he's asking for aren't always what he delivers. And that's what gets in the way. Because, you know, as Willie Lament says about Baxter, the ultimate pathos of his life is that distinction between means and ends, between that wanting to end controversy and this tendency always to provoke it. So the kind of contradiction that I'm trying to get at is that one, trying to bring about peace by arguing for let's use as few words as possible. At the same time, will the guy never shut up, right? You know, there's just something in there. I mean, six books on this topic. Is one not enough? Now, I love Baxter, but let's just acknowledge that that guy could write, really. Maybe he should have been looking after his wife at that point, really.
Yesterday we heard a lecture on what was it, the insufficiency of the pulpit in Richard Baxter, where Baxter's making the argument that he needs to do more one-on-one preaching and visitation with his people for fear that they don't properly understand his preaching. And here he seems to have a desire to really want to communicate in more layman's terms. Was that a particular passion for Baxter, communicate with the...
Well, absolutely, it's his concern to communicate with the average person. But if you look at Catholic theology, I'm not sure the average uneducated person could possibly understand the first part. They'd have a better chance, I think, of understanding that book two, where you've got those conversations. You know, that's quite an accessible way in. Let's imagine three guys having a conversation, and this guy's talking to that one, and that's a much more accessible book. But you know, the really striking thing, it was so striking to me as I read Owen's books, is how utterly accessible they are. And this is Owen, right? Who, by all accounts, whose writing is inscrutable and inaccessible. Listen, that I don't think that's true in those books in the 1670s. I think the genius of Crawford's book is that he I don't know if I can say this, Crawford, but what Crawford did was he read through Owen's works in chronological order. I don't know if anyone's ever done that.
It's called the Cooper method.
No, it's not. It's the Gribben method. And, read them in order. And what you see is Owen changing, right? Absolutely. So, you know, in the 1670s when he's saying, look, I'm not going to use philosophical terms. Well, that's different. You know, Owen's as good as any at using philosophical terms. But he's not going to. And I was just struck in reading his book. How accessible it is. He's just got this basic concern that people are saved. And you know, I have to say, at that point, he's doing a better job of that for the average person than Baxter is in Catholic theology. Yeah.
So it seems like with so much of the conflict being centered on the emphasis in content, and specifically like the results they expected to get from that content, how much does the disparity in their educational background feed into how this conflict develops?
Yeah, see, it's ironic, isn't it, that the one who is university trained, who is Mr. University, is John Owen, right? Vice Chancellor of Oxford University in the 1650s, Doctor of Divinity. You can't get any more university than that. He's the one who disavows metaphysical terms and philosophical distinctions. The guy who didn't go to university and who I'm convinced was always acutely aware of it and felt conscious of it is Baxter. And he's the one who's projecting the Latin terms and metaphysical distinctions. And look, please take me seriously when I say I don't want to psychologize these guys. But that's curious to me, that you get that discrepancy at that point in the 1670s. So I think that different educational formation is in play in an ironic kind of way, because the result you might expect is not the result you get in each case. That's my best guess. No. The most he could concede was that John Bunyan was a pretty godly guy. That's about as much as you'll get out of Baxter. In that sense, he is either or. You just can't be antinomian.
Right. So there were lines in the group.
Yep. Yep. Great point. Yep. I don't think he's going to get a antinomian and say to him, "Listen, we agree." Right, so fair enough. Yep, there are lines. It's not both and all the way. There are certain positions he's not going to give away. But in the debate between Arminianism and Calvinism, and in this decline of Calvinism through the 17th century, he's really got no, to generalize, he's got no interest to stop that, because both sides, in his mind, are of a mind, which is an incredible thing to say, really. But that's what he says in Catholic theology.
Okay. I'm coming to this question, understanding, presuppose I read your book, how Baxter got to soteriology. So we quickly talked about that yesterday. Understanding that, you said something that was fantastic, where Owen wanted to win Calvin, Baxter wanted to end it.
Yep.
Is it too far insane why Owen wanted to win it is because Owen saw himself within the realm of that confessional tradition.
tradition, Baxter, in the light of his printing aphorisms, clearly in his opponents at that time saw him outside of that confessional tradition with such things as he says of imputation, of justification, those things. So Baxter's rhetoric changes to unity and peace because he wants to get rid of those details so that he can include himself within that confessional realm at that time, because it's those distinctives that would keep him out of that and accepted within that realm of orthodoxy.
That's a very good question. If I'm understanding it right, I don't think that's what Baxter is seeking to do. Because just to say a few things. First of all, I think Owen is a Calvinist, and I think Baxter is a confused Calvinist. So I don't want to say Baxter's not Calvinist. The second thing I'd say about Baxter is that he's never happier than when he's in a party of one. So, you know, if he's not in your group, that's vindication, right? There's no group that he wants to be a part of, except his own group of mere Catholics, of Presbyterians, Congregationalists, Episcopalians. You know, he says this at several points. You know, I'm just a mere Catholic, and the only one who's in his group is him, right? So I don't think that's it. I think he's governed by this instinct. I'm pushing it, all right? This is an original argument that I'm pushing. Be aware of that. But I think he wants all wars to end, including this one. That's what's driving him. Why are you fighting? We don't need to fight because actually we all agree, right? Now for Owen, I really believe that he holds fast to Calvinism because Calvinism for him is the saving gospel. And to dilute it is to move to something that is not the saving gospel. And he has been profoundly saved. And I think he needs to hold on to that, because to let that go is to risk that trauma, that inner trauma that he went through for himself or others. And he can't do that. Yeah. Yeah, Seth. Yeah.
Where he's actually genuinely taking time to think, like, am I doing this the right way? Am I going about it the right way? Is it something in my personality or way of coming across?
Let me just say that if you love Baxter, I love Baxter too, but self-awareness is not one of his great gifts. He also has a great ability to make what looks like an apology. But if you read it two or three times and think really hard about it and his choice of words, what it actually is a justification. And so at the same time as if you weren't paying attention, you might think he's apologizing for his behavior. He's actually criticizing those who are offended by his behavior. So I'm sorry, but I can't think of a single time, and that might be too strong, where I can't think of a moment where he stops and he thinks, hang on a minute. It's been decades, all these words, it's not working, let me try something different, right? Because even when you come to the republication of Tobias Crisp's works in, is it 89 or 90, somewhere in there, I mean, Richard Baxter's dead in a couple of years and still out he comes with material that he's written 30 years earlier to try and defeat this ancient foe. So, I mean, I could spend my life dealing with Baxter. Be great. I'm happy with that. But he's just not one to reflect like that. I just don't think he does that.
Similar in the 1650s, but it reduces the Christian religion to 16 sentences.
for a document that could have been the foundation of the Cromwellian.
Yeah.
But by the time we come to the 1660s, 1670s, 1680s,
yeah.
Owen is not defending, well, correct me if I'm wrong, but Owen's not defending the Reformed faith but with reference to a confession of faith. Is he?
No.
He's doing it on the basis of the text of Jesus.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I agree.
So have both of these writers moved beyond thinking of Calvinism in relation to a statement of faith?
Yeah. Look, I think that's an excellent question. If you were paying attention, you might notice that what I never did in the course of that paper was define what I meant by Calvinism, and I'm still not. But you've put your finger on that, the uncanny thing is in the late 60s, there's Baxter and Owen. Well, Baxter tries to engineer a reconciliation with Owen. And he goes along to Owen and says, you know, maybe we can work together. Maybe we can find some common ground. And one of the things that Owen says is basically, you know what, Richard? I now agree with you on a minimalist confession. And Crawford, you found that in the early 60s, right at the beginning of the 60s. Owen is saying this. So Owen says this to Baxter, and Baxter just ignores that. Here's this major concession on this point that divided them in the 1650s, and it's like Owen never spoke, right? Baxter just doesn't register it. He just keeps on talking. I agree with that. What Owen is defending is not Calvinism, right? Because let's not just equate Owen with Calvin. That would be a very bad move. Owen, you know, Carl Truman is right. Yeah, Owen's heritage is long and deep. But I think the way you've put it, Crawford, there is very good. He's defending his reading of the Bible and his experience of the Bible. And his experience was salvation by the saving truth, that it's the righteousness of Christ imputed to me that saves and nothing else. And so it's not confessional at that point, and that's a very helpful distinction. Yeah.
Any other questions before we conclude? Well, thank you very, very much.
Thank you.